Thanks, Rajesh, the organizers here, and my dear colleagues. Mr. Ajay Bhushan Pandey, Mr. Agarwal, Sir Rajesh Agarwal, Mr. Agarwal from Delhi, and Mr. Agarwal from Mumbai. Mr. Ravi Gupta, a very old colleague of mine from my Delhi days, actually. Very happy to see him yesterday after a very long gap. My colleagues from the NIC, particularly Mr. Hussain and his team here, Collector Sindhudurg, representatives from the other states, delegates, people from the media, colleagues from the media, and colleagues from the industry. Well, a very happy good morning to you in Mumbai here. I would like to welcome all of you on behalf of the state government to the state of Maharashtra and to the city of Mumbai. It's a great city, as you know, and of late, from the manufacturing industry, it has now shifted to more service industry. Unfortunately, the IT is not picking up in Mumbai, but it would slowly but surely, actually. Well, I'm very happy to be here for the inaugural function for eGov Maharashtra, basically, and which is a great platform, not only within the government, cutting across the states and Government of India. Government of India is the big brother. They play a very important role in guiding several of the policies. And also the various state governments who come out with different programs, actually. Most of this is driven by the private sector industry, but also there are very important government agencies, and I would like to specifically mention the role of the NIC here. CDAC is another very important agency, and obviously we know the world and global famous now, the UID, etc. So the government agencies are also playing a very critical role in addition to the state departments. While we continue to battle as to what needs to be done, more needs to be done, and better, in a better way we need to do it, some of the issues are basically fundamental issues, and the domain knowledge of the departments and the ground realities has to be merged with the technology. The application technology is obviously not going to do miracles unless the people behind it are really going to make it happen, as we say. And I'm pretty sure everybody in this hall would like to share the glimpses of sort of satisfaction which we have when we initially drive the program. But after some time, unfortunately, it so happens that several of these programs being driven by individuals who are highly motivated are not in a position to implant them in our systems. And if they are not in a position to implant in their systems, then they have a very short life and they go away with the person. So it's a very systematic approach which would allow the e-governance to really make a difference. It's more than a decade now that we've been talking about e-governance, and we have got success stories of various kinds. The good part of it is that all of us have believed that e-governance is the key to bring transparency in the governance, efficiency in the governance, speed in the governance, and obviously it is going to bring a low-cost solution relative to what we have got in terms of the manual manpower which is required to really deliver several of the systems. The other advantages which we know on the e-governance is not only the scale at which it can operate and its quick escalation and percolation down the line, because normally what we are finding is anything which is to be done at the government level, at the government headquarters, whether in Delhi or the state headquarters, ultimately to percolate it down to the villages is a major challenge. And that is where several of the issues which are there regarding connectivities, accessibilities, in addition to the basic infrastructure of the power availability is a major issue, but the offline modules which we have been able to develop are really going to make a difference. My request to all the participants would be, while they would like to definitely showcase their success stories here and share their experiences, I think there should be some amongst us here who should be having the courage to say, well, not only I succeeded in some of the ventures, but I failed here, and these were the reasons of the failure. And if you have the courage to say that, and how you've been able to overcome these challenges, it's going to make a big difference, because success stories are viewed from our point of view. And we have been asking the departments here, particularly led by Mr. Rajesh Agarwal, get an external audit, external validation of the claims which you are making. For example, not only we are talking about the principal stakeholder, the public at large, how they are viewing all these e-governance initiatives, how do the public representatives at different forums perceive this? Now, if the public representatives at various levels, whether they are the members of the Gram Panchayat or the Panchayat Samitis or the municipal corporators as we have them, or the elected representatives at a higher level in terms of the MLAs and the MPs, if they are with us on board, it would make a big difference. And that evaluation, unfortunately, we do not have for several of the programs, except once in a while in a typical speech, we would talk about the e-initiatives. I would also like to mention here that some of the key departments which will be driving the e-governance programs will be, in terms of an institution, obviously the collector's office is one of the most important one, and we have got a bright young collector here, my colleague Virender Singh from Sindhudurg, who is going to talk, I'm pretty sure, about his e-office initiative in the district of Sindhudurg. So, but what we have realized increasingly is it's not the collector's office alone at the district level which needs to be going into the e-governance modes on a wholesome basis, but the Zilla Parishad, that is the CEO of the Zilla Parishad, and the municipal commissioners, and most importantly the superintendent of police. Now, unless we have got a full package over there, we are not going to make a difference in an area of excellence of islands, as we call them. The collector's office itself is a large enough office at the district level, but not the only office, and that is going to make a difference. And the beauty of the Sindhudurg model has been that it is not a lateral invasion of the e-governance, but it is a top-down approach from the collector's office right up to the village level officers, and that is the importance of this, etc. So the backward linkage from the lowest revenue official to the collector's office, cutting across the tehsildars and the ASDOs and whatever we have, has been established. The next step is the forward linkage to the divisional commissioner and the various departments in the government. But it's a great effort. Hopefully it will be sustained and multiplied. And the good part of that story of Sindhudurg has been that we got now two more districts, Jalna and Nandurbar, if I remember correctly. They're also trying to do it. And it's important to understand the amount of effort which goes into each one of these projects and how it is driven by the individual initially, who creates a team around him or her, and then actually it is taken up. Unless there is a full team, it's simply not possible. And for this particular effort, we would like to put on record our deep appreciation and acknowledgement of the NIC team from Delhi and from Mumbai, actually. Without their support, it was simply not possible to do this. So it's a win-win situation when Government of India and its outfits join hands with the state governments in any case, etc. And the state government here does not include only the secretariat or the mantralaya, as we call here, but right up to the field level here, sir. Now, I would like to specifically mention some of the key areas which I'm pretty sure my colleague, Mr. Rajesh Agarwal, and some of the other representatives from the various departments are going to talk about. So I was mentioning about the key departments. And to us, finance department is one of the key departments really driving this program. And if the finance department drives this program, it would make a huge difference, basically. We have been focusing on the departments which are in the social sector, whether it's education, health, social services of various kinds. We can talk about that. There's no doubt about it that they ultimately give direct benefits to the individual beneficiaries as such. But if you look to the systematic changes which the government needs to address, finance department is one of the key departments, and unless it takes it up, the e-governance initiative, in a major way, we are not really going to make a major difference. Whether it's running through the treasuries, the collection of the government amounts, actually, etc. We have got the people from the finance department here. They will talk about GRAS, basically, which is the government receipt or systems, basically. And it makes fundamental changes. I've got my colleagues hopefully here from the CELTEX department. Now, what has the CELTEX department of Maharashtra done which possibly no other department has been able to do? While you continue to get online information from all your vendors and business associates, etc., etc., what it has been able to do is put up a business intelligence unit. Now, unless you've got a business intelligence unit, we are really not going to able to use this data. And therefore, my request to all the participants here and those of you already in this field have advanced ahead. Please try to demonstrate that what you have not only facilitated is the data collection processes, making it available, allowing it to be manipulated, but how this information can lead to better governance. For the CELTEX department, among other things, is not only the higher revenue collection, but the ease with which business people are able to associate themselves with the CELTEX department, for example. Now, if you are able to demonstrate this, then we have made a difference. And this again brings to the question which I began right at the outset, is the business process re-engineering, etc. That is what e-governance should be able to allow us to do, etc. If you are not able to demonstrate the business process re-engineering, I don't think we are going to make a headway except using computers instead of using files over there, etc. So the business process re-engineering, and that is where the domain knowledge would come. Very few examples again which we would like to demonstrate here, and I'm pretty sure Rajesh is going to do that. Now, the whole country is busy, and we got Dr. Ajay Bhushan Pandey here also, a wonderful colleague here, who understands the nitty-gritties of the UID. Now, when we started looking at the UID and the data, and it's the most fantastic data sets, or at least one of the most great data set which the country is producing at the All India level, etc. How do you start using it, etc.? What is the quality of the data, etc.? And unless we are able to demonstrate some of these issues, the basic principles of e-governance would be lost, basically. Now, what Rajesh has done is put up a UID innovation center in his office, etc., which is manned by about 20-25 young people over there, etc. Started filtering the data, looking at the data, and the basics of data collections were basically examined. Validity of the data was examined. Unless you have validated the data, you cannot really put it to greater use over there, etc. And we requested him to only find out one simple thing: how many villages in Maharashtra have started having the UID collection process? And he mapped it out just to find out that most of the UID in Maharashtra of a particular date a couple of months back was focused only in the cities and some villages, actually. So the UID data collection itself had not percolated, and Maharashtra, Rajesh tells me, is now virtually going to be the number one state in the country in terms of the absolute number for the UID collection here, etc., crossing 6 crores very soon, basically. Now, that is a simple demonstration as to when we are trying to reach the services to the villages, it becomes important for us to know how many villages have we been able to penetrate. And several other works in this UID Innovation Center has been done, and I'm pretty sure Rajesh and his team are willing to take up literally the entire country's data validation process for UID. And that's a tremendous thing, because they have gone into the basics, have worked so much on finding out what are the tools for validation. And I would like to really, acknowledge all the efforts made by Rajesh and his team over there, sir. Another effort which has been made by the Revenue Secretary, and I'm pretty sure Swadin, another of my senior colleague, is going to come here and talk to you about this, on the basic revenue governance, etc. And a couple of days back, we started launching the e-Chowdy and whatever we have, actually, etc. But the key question which I would like to put to the audience, and some of you are involved with the basics of the revenue department in terms of the revenue records being updated, we have not been able to mine that data. So while we talk that, like for in Maharashtra, we got more than 8,000 village revenue officials having the laptops, okay, and they are trying to do the mutation entry and update here, etc. But the fundamental issues still need to be addressed. From these revenue records, as on a particular date, can I draw a simple thing like how many cultivators are available, having 1 hectare of land, 2 hectares of land, and so on and so forth? That I am not able to do today. So ultimately, data collection, data mining, data exploitation, use of the data, we are not able to demand. Simple thing I am asking, sir. We are not in a position to estimate even now correctly the number of mutation entries which take place in the entire state. It should be possible. I see no reason it's not be done. As a matter of fact, the challenge which I put to my colleagues in the revenue department and the agriculture department along with the IT is simply the fact that what is the area sown under a particular crop, it should be coming from the revenue records. If my village revenue officials, the way what they have been doing for hundreds of years manually entering the crop which the farmers have sown, now why can't I get it compiled straight away, sir? So these are the challenges which we need to really find out. Otherwise, we are talking to ourselves, we are saying that yes, we have introduced e-governance in the revenue department, we have used e-governance in the UID, we have done e-governance in the finance here, etc. Has it affected the life of the people? And I think one of the best examples which I have been quoting in the past and which I'll quote again today, the demonstration of the online railway reservation systems. It really demystified the entire issue of the railway reservation system which we used to have in the 1980s and 1990s, etc. And that has really brought considerable amount of relief to the people, whatever we may have the shortcomings here, etc. Something like this, if it can be demonstrated, then it is going to make a major impact. I wish this conference all success. I would have been happier here on the other side listening to some of the presentations here, etc., picking up ideas which will agitate us to take our state forward. But what I would really like to say is I would like to thank Ravi for taking the initiative and all the participants here and all the sponsors who are here. Thanks to them, Maharashtra would love to be the number one state. We always claim we are one among the many, but we would like to be the number one in any case here, etc. And you could help us in this. I would only like to say that our Chief Minister is very keen on the e-governance issues. Several of our ministers not only use iPads for the assembly, actually, you know, when in a typically assembly session, when there are questions in the assembly, you have to start giving them notes, scribbling on paper, etc. Some of the ministers have stopped doing that, etc. There's an iPad over there and there are enough notes over there, the minister is able to draw without several of us scribbling notes. So small, small initiatives which have made a difference. I would also like to thank the NIC team from Mumbai which is here. They've been a great source of strength, and to the UID team led by Dr. Ajay Pandey here. And finally, my colleague Mr. Rajesh Agarwal and his team who have worked very hard. I hope you will enjoy your sessions. I would like to be here hopefully in the afternoon. I have just been informed that one of my meetings at 12:30 has been cancelled. So let me try to find out if I can come back. I would like to be here. Thank you for giving this opportunity. I wish you